Gentlemen, your excellencies, I would like to welcome you to the forum. It is great pleasure of having so many participants here this afternoon. My name is Mika Aaltola, director of the Finnish Institute of International Affairs, and I'm participating from Helsinki. I've been following, as we all have, closely the corona situation and the worsening of it, and one of the key observations that I have made has to do with the political ramifications of COVID-19 situation. And I would like to make some welcoming remarks on that, on those observations. It has been exceptional shock, COVID-19, and that is not only because of its severity. It is a health crisis matching the fallout from the Spanish flu, and it has compounded economic crisis unrivaled in peacetime. In a world challenged by COVID-19, leaders will have to adapt to a host of rapidly evolving challenges and opportunities. The cascading issues, not to mention only the economy, have to do with societies, the societal clue, and the trust levels in different societies. COVID-19 gives us an x-ray of the cohesion of particular European societies. On the international level, the growing trend among leaders has been competition rather than cooperation, although there has been signs of compassion, solidarity as well. COVID-19 shock has prompted an economic collapse very fast that has been unrivaled, as mentioned before. The opinion polling results show severe drops in interpersonal and institutional trust in number of European countries. However, this has not been a general trend in the Nordic Baltic region, and this is a little bit different in this neck of the woods. But polling data also suggests a rallying effect around scientific expertise and incumbent governments, those governments that are in power currently. During the first wave, the populist positions were losing ground in different Western democratic countries, and especially in the European Union. Trust in police, experts, and scientists has gone up. The data also has hinted at a growing demand for competence, and I would like to repeat this word, competence, competent governance. The map of disease spread has always been a telltale signifier of competent governance and good governance. Lower levels of corona carriers, hospitalizations, and deaths have been a norm in the northern regions so far. There's a couple of exceptions from that, but clearly the Nordic Baltic region has managed to show also competent phase of governance. And this is something that it will be remembered in this region and also beyond, depending, of course, on how the second wave or possible third wave before we have medications or vaccinations available is going to carry itself out. But those words concerning the situation and what it has revealed, I would like to yield the floor to our next speaker. So good luck, and enjoy the forum from my perspective.
Thank you very much, Mika, for the nice introductory words. And I would also like to warmly welcome all of the participants and our honored speakers today. Also on behalf of Institut für Europäische Politik, where I'm one of the two directors. And I'm happy and delighted to be able to open this opening session of this year's German Nordic Baltic Forum. The German Nordic Baltic Forum is a multilateral discussion format that assembles experts and so-called planners, which are representatives from ministries and their planning staffs, from Germany as well as the Nordic, Baltic and Baltic countries, with the aim to discuss national perspectives on current challenges and opportunities to the European Union. This forum provides room for identifying where national interests of the involved countries diverge and where we can find common ground for common action. In 2020, we did not have to dig very deep to identify challenges that could guide our discussions. The COVID-19 pandemic, as has just been described, is impacting all of our everyday lives and has also challenged the EU member states to agree on common actions because it's considered to be a symmetric crisis with asymmetric effects that we then all have to deal with. This means, on the one hand, the pandemic might have intensified or accelerated existing crises or challenges in the European Union, or at least pointed out those areas where reform is urgently needed. On the other hand, the pandemic has also called for common action that might even drive European integration further. At the same time, we also have to look beyond the pandemic in order to grasp the full picture of challenges and opportunities for the future of the European Union. We identified four broader topics that we think deserve more detailed discussions, and that is the European Green Deal, the EU and multilateralism, the EU's resilience, and the economic recovery. There is this common saying that we should never waste a good crisis, and I think we should not waste this pandemic for discussing the future of the European Union. Within this forum, we do not want to exclusively discuss behind closed doors, which we're going to do tomorrow and also in December, but traditionally open the forum with a public debate where we can find inspiration for our discussions, both in the keynote addresses as well as the questions from the broader audience. This year, however, there are some things that are new. First of all, we meet virtually instead of face-to-face. And we also want to include younger perspectives into the debate and therefore ask young experts as well as one rapporteur from the Engage Your Council project to provide first comments to the keynote addresses in order to kick us off for our broader discussion. Before introducing our today's speakers, please allow me to thank our partner institute, the Finnish Institute of International Affairs in Helsinki, who would have liked to host us in Helsinki, actually, but is now our virtual host today. Let me also thank the Federal Foreign Office in Berlin and the Finnish Ministry of Foreign Affairs for the kind support to the German Nordic Baltic Forum. I also need to remind ourselves of the technical rules that will allow us to communicate smoothly during the discussion. So please turn off your cameras if you're not a speaker and you haven't done so already. Please mute your mics whenever you're not speaking. If you want to participate in the Q&A part of the discussion later, you can do so in two ways. Either identify in the chat function that you would want to ask a question orally, or you can spell out your question directly in the chat function, and I'm going to address your question in the discussion. As we will have to close the session today at 4 o'clock, I'm not going to lose any more time, and I'm delighted to be able to welcome our two keynote speakers. I know that both of you must be very busy, and also Minister Roth, with regards to the German presidency, I'm sure that there are many things to do at the moment. So we are very honored that you actually took your time to participate in this discussion and share your thoughts on the general topic that we found for this forum, 2020 as a stress test for the European Union, challenges in times of the COVID-19 pandemic. And I'm very delighted to first hand over the floor to Tytti Tuppurainen, who is Minister for European Affairs and Ownership Steering at the Prime Minister's Office in Finland. Thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you, Chair. Vielen Dank, meine Damen und Herren, ladies and gentlemen. This year has been exceptional. This is the year of the pandemic. Next year will not be a walk in the park either. Nevertheless, we should aim at coming out of the crisis as a union that is more resilient, and I have 3 points on this. First is the fundamental role of the rule of law. Second, I will argue that an open economy is a prerequisite for resilience. And finally, in my view, EU should not fall between US-China disputes, but act strongly according to our values. First, rule of law provides predictability and trust to our mutually dependent economies. It is a basic requirement for a functioning single market and for our credibility as trading partner. However, it is not just about markets. The European Union is first and foremost a union of values. The rule of law is the core principle of our societies. It is the foundation of any free society. As 27 member states met in last July to make the decision about the MFF and the recovery fund, we were convinced that these decisions were necessary to defend the solidarity within our union. And we were equally convinced that the union worth defending is a union founded on the principle of rule of law. Our common values are the bedrock of resilience. I am delighted that the German EU presidency has put rule of law high on its agenda. Minister Roth, lieber Michael, die Rechtsstaatlichkeit wollen wir fest entschlossen verteidigen, gemeinsam Europa wieder stark zu machen. Second, they say EU evolves as a result of crisis, and it is proving to be true once again. Personally, I do not like the idea of rooting for crisis to propel us ahead. But resilience has quickly become a common and cross-cutting top priority as we are tackling this latest crisis. My message is, the basic elements for strengthening the union's resilience are more or less the same as the elements for enhancing growth, competitiveness, and the ultimate goal, our well-being. The union has been able to rise to the occasion by agreeing upon a recovery package, which forms our common fiscal policy response to the crisis. The investments facilitated by it will enhance our competitiveness and transform our economies to be more sustainable or more resilient, so to speak. While we coordinate our fiscal policies and investments like never before, we should not forget the EU's traditional core businesses, namely strengthening the single market and promoting free, fair and rules-based global trade. These are policy areas where the EU can offer real added value to each of its member states while contributing to the EU's prosperity and resilience. When talking about resilience, one cannot avoid referring to strategic autonomy, a concept initially used in the field of security and defense policy. In the current debate, it is not always clear what is concretely meant by strategic autonomy. I tend to think that resilience and strategic autonomy are two different issues. Part of the discussion around strategic autonomy or sovereignty is linked to the unfair global competition. But I don't think that our answer on leveling the playing field should be compromising the competition or competition policy or state aid rules. What is reasonable, however, is that the third country operators doing business in the single market play under the same rules that the European counterparts are required to do. We should be asking for reciprocity. Neither do I consider it realistic to return the production of value chains back home, as it hardly brings us sovereignty in the longer run. This was actually one of the main findings of the recent publication by ECIPE, which confirmed that global value chains have kept Europe indeed more resilient during the pandemic. Having said this, it is still evident that there are certain critical sectors where production capacity needs our attention. One can think of sectors closely connected to health and safety. So for me, strategic autonomy is not about building walls and barriers around Fortress Europe. Instead, it is about improving our competitiveness and investing in innovation so that we are a global trading partner that nobody can ignore. In a nutshell, I call us to remain vigilant to the risk of strategic autonomy ending up being protectionism. Third point. Some have called for the EU to provide a third way in disputes between the US and China. High Representative Borrell has written an interesting piece arguing in favor of EU's Sinatra doctrine, of course a reference to his famous song My Way. The EU should not fall victim to the US-China disputes, which have been very harmful to multilateral rules-based governance, which we all depend on. We should definitely find our own way, tailor what kind of a world and global order we want to build, and then use all our instruments to promote our goals. Let me take an example. The fact is that data has become globally a key resource. On the global stage, there are differing approaches to data. On the one hand, in the East, we have a rising superpower where the state has significant control over data. Across the Atlantic, the field is dominated by tech giants with very light regulatory coverage. We are clearly lacking a comprehensive global data governance model. This is an opportunity the EU should seize, just like we did when creating a GDPR regime, which major economies are now following. The EU can fulfill the vacuum by providing a model where people can have control over their own data, and the regulation is based on the principles of trust and privacy, freedom of speech, and human dignity. Ladies and gentlemen, finding our own way should not mean Europe first, not in the spirit of the famous red baseball caps. Our success will always depend on cooperation to solve the global challenges of our times. The EU must show leadership in building coalitions and partnerships in support of effective multilateralism. Germany has done a lot in this regard under the Alliance for Multilateralism. Thank you for that, Michal. Neither should the EU's position in the world be described as a neutral third way in between US and China. With that policy, in a world that may split into two, Europe would fall into abyss. We must look at the world based on our own values and our own point of view and act accordingly. We must be principled to our own values and interests towards all global players. Often our interests coincide with the US, the transatlantic bond is deep, but that's not always the case. I don't make any forecast for the US presidential elections, but I don't think it is altogether impossible that we will have a US government more willing to cooperate with Europe. Should this opportunity arise, we should not spare our ambition. One such action should be re-entering negotiations on a comprehensive EU-US trade and investment agreement. A successful agreement would persuade China to follow Euro-Atlantic standards in trade and investment regulation. Ladies and gentlemen, in 1969, Henry Kissinger said, "There cannot be a crisis next week. My schedule is already full." He sure has lived a busy life. I'm convinced that we can come out of this crisis as a union that successfully builds the future on our core strengths like the rule of law, single market, and open economy. A union that is able to make independent policy choices at the global level based on our interests and values, and as a union that is more resilient. We recently celebrated the anniversary of the German reunification. Just like 30 years ago, we must now act, open the gate, and face new Europe. In my mind, Europe shall become the most competitive, socially inclusive, carbon-neutral economy in the world. Vielen Dank für Ihre Aufmerksamkeit. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Tuppurainen, for this very comprehensive elaboration on the EU's resilience. And you mentioned that, you know, the schedule being full when the crisis hit, or being not prepared, or a crisis hits when the schedule is already full. And I think that was also something that applied to the German presidency when the program was almost drafted, and then the pandemic hit the continent, and then it kind of required detailed redrafting and also a recalibration of the meetings that were planned and everything. So I think this is also something that Germany had to deal with in the past months. But I'm also very interested in hearing Mr. Roth's views on the stress test this year and the opportunities for the European Union ahead of us. And I'm very delighted to be able to give the floor to our Minister for European Affairs, Mr. Roth.
Yeah, thank you, Chair, and thank you, Tytti, for your inspiring speech and for your true friendship in challenging times for all of us. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm very delighted to be speaking to you today at the opening of the 12th German Nordic Baltic Forum 2020. This year's forum is taking place under the special circumstances of a global pandemic that were impossible to predict just a year ago. These circumstances have shaped our joint challenges and also the priorities of the German Council presidency. You invited me to share some optimism and some encouraging ideas with you. Let's try. The pandemic has accentuated the competition between major global powers and, as a consequence, has highlighted the need for Europe to be more sovereign, more resilient, and more independent. We must strengthen our healthcare systems, diversify our supply chains, and minimize dependencies in particularly critical areas. In particular, we need to ensure the availability of essential goods such as protective equipment and medicine. The fact that in July, the EU member states came together to agree on an unprecedented financial package to tackle the economic and social consequences of the pandemic gives cause for optimism. The package consists of the next multi-annual financial framework and the recovery plan Next Generation EU. This agreement is an important manifestation of EU solidarity. This joint effort will help all member states to alleviate the challenges posed by COVID-19 and at the same time sets the course for the future of Europe. The current negotiations with the European Parliament are really complicated and complex, but I can see a spirit of common purpose on all sides. As our presidency motto puts it, together for Europe's recovery. Although we are still in the middle of dealing with the COVID-19 pandemic, we should already start to learn the lessons from this crisis. We have to make sure our economies recover in a sustainable manner, in line with the Green Deal, and with a clear focus on social cohesion. Even though COVID-19 is putting our economies, our health, and our social life under considerable strain with regard to climate change, we should use it as an opportunity, a chance to foster the green transition of our economies, a chance for a real ecological turnaround that reconciles economic growth with environmental needs. It's important to stress that this is not about an either-or decision between the Green Deal and recovery programs. It's essential that the EU remains on track to achieve substantial emissions reductions that is of 55% by 2030 and actively supports the goals set by the Paris Climate Agreement. We need to act now for the future. Especially in these difficult times, it's important not to lose sight of our common goals and values. And for me, the fact that we are managing to make progress on important issues, even in times of crisis, is yet another cause for optimism. Especially in times like these, when democracy and the rule of law are under pressure, by nationalists and populists. Europe needs to defend these fundamental values to protect our common democratic achievements, past and present. The EU is first and foremost a union of common values. We're not just a single market, not just a currency union. The new format of the rule of, and we would like to implement two new tools. The first one is the so-called rule of law conditionality embedded into the MFF and the recovery package. And the second new tool is the so-called rule of law dialogue, the rule of law check, based on the Commission's rule of law report. It's a major step forward in regaining a common, a mutual understanding of the rule of law in the European Union. With the first horizontal debate in October and with the exchange on individual countries' chapters, which are due to start on the 10th of November, a precedent will be set. We will consolidate it together with the upcoming presidencies. What we also need in this changing world is resilient societies, both online and offline. And it's paramount that in our union of common values, the EU preserves and even strengthens its commitment to the rule of law in all member states, an issue which is very dear to my heart. The EU is also facing an increasing number of external challenges. Only together can we be a strong advocate for European values and successfully face these challenges on the global stage. And here, Europe must not allow itself to be divided. Recent developments in relation to China, to Russia, or to Turkey, but also to the United States, are testing our capacity to act and will continue to do so in the future. We therefore have to improve our capacity to act together on foreign and security policy issues. If we want to make the world a better place, we have to stand united. We have to overcome our disputes. Furthermore, we need to accelerate the building of our technological sovereignty and digital transformation, as the pandemic has shown. Let's not see this crisis as a setback. I can't argue more with Tytti. Rather, let's view it as a wake-up call to stand up for our European approach to current challenges based on our common values and led by our joint interests. Together, we will be able to find solutions. We need to set the course for the future right now. 12 years after the German Nordic Baltic Forum, it's quite a legacy. This just underlines the importance of these valuable exchange formats. I'm very much convinced that an in-depth exchange between Nordic, Baltic, and German representatives will bring positive and progressive ideas to feed into this debate on the future of a united, sovereign, and resilient Europe. I hope for new ideas and inspiration from your discussion today, and I'm very much looking forward to learning more about your perspectives. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Roth, for this sharing your optimism with us, but also sharing, you know, your feeling for urgency for the need to act. And I think both of you were very explicit, and I think you both agreed on the importance of the rule of law issues or issue for the resilience of the European Union. And I think this is something that we're definitely going to discuss also in the upcoming sessions. But I would now like to first hand the floor to our commentators in order to hear their thoughts on what they have heard right now and also on certain topics before I open the floor to the broader public. But while we are listening to the commentators, you can already I already invite you to frame your questions and identify yourself in the chat if you want to ask a question so that we can enter into the discussion without any further delay after the comments. But first, I would like to hand over to Piret Kuusik, who is a junior research fellow at the Estonian Foreign Policy Institute in Estonia. And she is not new to the forum, actually, because she was co-organizing the forum last year with IEP together, and also contributed to lively to the discussions. Her research focuses on EU's foreign and security policy, German-Franco relationship, and Baltic Sea region's role in Europe and the world. And Piret, I would be interested, I mean, we heard lots of things about the rule of law issues right now, but maybe you would want also to pick up more on the second issue that Mrs. Tuppurainen was also referring to, the open economy, the economic recovery, but just share your spontaneous thoughts with us and your comments to what you've just heard.
Indeed. Greetings from Tallinn. As said, both ministers mentioned the economic recovery, and I have to say that I cannot help not wonder is that we are just coming out of another crisis, which is the financial crisis, almost a decade ago, and we're still dealing with the political consequences of the crisis. And what worries me increasingly is that we're not really, or is the European Union really thinking ahead of what that coming crisis will mean to people's real lives? If I follow the debates in Brussels today, Green Deal is one of the central drivers of the debate. But at the same time, it is somewhat abstract to a general citizen. And I am a tad afraid that while we talk about the future and the Green Deal, that the European Union might miss the reality that people and the challenges that the citizens are facing, and to some extent, the European Union will not be able to actually speak to the people. And the reason why I've come to this thought is that Estonia's government has signed up to the Green Deal, and at the European level, we are very pro-Green Deal. However, it is not the issue that the government and the party gained its electoral victory. And so if you go to and talk to an Estonian citizen, I'm pretty sure that they have no knowledge about the Green Deal. And my worry is, how do we meet those two? Thank you.
Thank you, Piret, for the very concise comment, and also raising the concern between, you know, how to meet politics with the public opinion and how to bring the two sides together, and the concerns that exist within the population in the different countries. I would like to hand over to Calle Håkansson, who is Associate Fellow at the Swedish Institute of International Affairs and a PhD candidate at Malmö University. And his research focuses on EU foreign and security policy, particularly in relation to the European Commission's growing role. But I think you are very apt to comment more maybe on Europe's role in the world and what that actually means in view of the current challenges and what you have just heard.
Thank you, Funda, and thanks to the Institute for European Politik and FIIA for inviting me to participate in this opening session. And also thanks to the ministers for their very interesting opening remarks. First of all, I just want to say that I think this is a great forum to enhance and deepen relations and understanding between these different countries and regions, which can serve as a stepping stone and provoke new ideas and thoughts. As you said, I will try to have some ideas and thoughts on one of the key subjects of this year's German Nordic Baltic Forum, the issue of Europe in the world. I really think that we need a more confident Europe and European Union in world affairs. The past couple of years, we have seen the deepening of cooperation in the field of foreign security and defense policy on the EU level, with the launching of new initiatives and tools such as PESCO, the European Defense Fund, and so on. However, we must be aware of a kind of a mission complete syndrome. Just that we have these different forums of cooperation doesn't make it finished. This is something that I really see as a risk among a lot of the member states. Hence, we need to continue to work hard on these efforts ahead. And I was, of course, a bit disappointed with the MFF and the overall budget decided this summer, which reduced the funding for new instruments such as the European Defense Fund, Military Mobility, and the European Peace Facility. However, I still think that we should see the glasses half full and not half empty, so to say. That we still see quite substantial EU financing in this field is something that we should recognize. And furthermore, I think it's important to leave the semantics behind and focus on the real issues. For example, the suspicion of the concept of EU strategic autonomy has long been rather high among some of the member states, among them Sweden. And this has partly led to a major conceptual debate in recent years, instead of focusing on what the EU and its member states really want to achieve. A possible solution to this could be the process that the EU during the German presidency right now is initiated with development of a strategic compass in security and defense. I would say that this is a needed process, which hopefully could complement and strengthening the EU global strategy. In this way, I also think it's good that we maybe are seeing the Franco-German engine gearing up again in this policy field. However, I also think that Sweden, as well as the other Nordic and Baltic states, really need to be proactive and engage in this debate and process to really be able to influence this. Likewise, so in the upcoming conference of the Future of Europe. So with that, I'm looking forward to the further discussions in the rest of the forum. I think it will be a great addition of the forum, despite that we cannot meet in Helsinki this year. Thank you.
Thank you, Calle. I think, yes, we all kind of not happy or not so happy about the fact that we cannot meet in Helsinki. But I think virtual meeting is also something that we kind of gotten used to and have to work with. But thank you for sharing your thoughts on Europe's role in the world and also taking up the idea of strategic autonomy that was also already mentioned. Now, last but not least, I would like to give the floor to one of our young rapporteurs from a project that we are coordinating at IEP, which we called Engage Your Council. And within this project, we are bringing together three times groups of people to elaborate their ideas and the young ideas for the upcoming presidency. And Maša, Ocvirk, I hope I'm kind of pronouncing your name correctly, but please correct me if I'm wrong, is one of the rapporteurs of the first group, who was very busy this summer, first of all, getting acquainted to being part of a virtual think tank, and second of all, coming up with their ideas that the German presidency should be addressing during this 6 months. And currently, the second group is busy defining and identifying their ideas and recommendations for the Portuguese presidency. So I'm very happy that Maša decided to join us today in order to share her insights on the young ideas that they elaborated during the first half of this year, and also discuss them with us today. So thank you, and you have the floor.
Thank you, Dr. Tekin, and special thanks to both ministers for their engaging opening remarks. I think we can all agree that we do live in challenging times and that this crisis has been a real stress test for the EU, be it economically, socially, or even geopolitically. When the EU is trying to manage this current crisis and advance forward-looking ideas for its future, 24 participants of the Engage EU Council project identified urgent challenges such as the promotion of the green recovery after the pandemic and achieving greater strategic autonomy of the EU as a foreign policy actor, and then develop ideas, which I will shortly present today, for how to turn this crisis into an opportunity for the EU. As it has already been emphasized several times, green transition needs to remain a key focus for the recovery and the MFF by using more funds for an industrial policy focused on green businesses and technologies, for a climate-friendly agriculture, and also for a deeper energy union that is focused on renewable energy. Another key element is transport. Here, the vision should be a sustainably interconnected Europe where rail travel can compete with plane travel, both in terms of duration and pricing. And there should also be focus more on participatory policymaking in this matter, be it in establishing new forms of citizens' assemblies through the Conference on the Future of Europe, or making citizens more aware of the consultation process in the ordinary legislative procedure. Then when it comes to the EU's role on the global stage, a recent quote from the president of the European Council comes to mind when he said that Europe is a major player, but doesn't yet know that it is. And for that, the EU needs to overcome its internal challenges by, for example, introducing qualified majority voting in some foreign policy decisions. It should also actively defend multilateral institutions and promote its values through strategic use of the already existing external action tools, such as strengthen its capacity to deploy military and civilian CSDP missions, better utilize coalitions and multilateral formats to pursue reforms of institutions and arrangements, such as the WTO, and undertake an even more ambitious climate diplomacy in free trade talks and agreements. And last but not least, focus should also be given to the reform of the EU official development assistance by implementing the Group of Wise Persons report on this matter, and especially give focus to the political and strategic guidance on development policy. So in these times, there is a clear need to use the recovery to achieve a green transition and solve long-standing problems. It needs to be made sure that the two major underpinnings of EU future, so the MFF and the conference, are fully utilized in order for the EU to pass this test with an excellent grade. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Maša, for re-emphasizing things that we have already heard, but also bringing new topics to our key terms to the discussion that we have not come across yet, like the Conference on the Future of Europe, for example. So thank you very much for this broad discussion. So there is one question in the chat forum, but I'm going to give the audience a bit more time to think about questions and that they would want to might want to raise, and would return the floor right away to back to the two ministers for initial reactions to things they have just heard with regards to the comments or things they would want to elaborate more in reaction to the comments. So, Mrs. Tuppurainen, if you would want to have the floor again.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair, and thank you very much for your valuable remarks. And, lieber Michael, vielen Dank für eine sehr gute Rede. It is always a pleasure to discuss with you and others, and I'm ever more grateful that we are so strongly united on the rule of law. Rule of law, like I said in my speech, is the core foundation of our union, and it needs to be defended right now. We have to be determined, yet we also have to have patience, because these are problems that are not solved over one night, so we have to act with a lot of patience, but determined. I would just like to comment on the unity of the union, because only when we are united can we act strongly at the global level in the sense of strategic autonomy. If we want to gain, you know, autonomy in the sense of foreign and security and defense policy, unity is the priority number one. If we want to gain importance as a global trading partner, unity again is a factor that we cannot ignore. So let's cherish the unity of our union because it is of utmost importance.
Thank you, Minister Tuppurainen, and Mr. Roth, did you want to come in with initial remarks and reactions?
Yes, my appreciation to all participants for their comments and for their critical statements. That's extremely valuable. I would like to point out just two topics. The first one is climate, and the second one is multilateralism. Climate. We shouldn't underestimate Europe's role as a role model, as an innovator. And I'm very, very proud of the new MFF. We are going to establish a new tool, a new instrument with a strong link to climate within the budget. We never had on the regional level, on the local level, or on the national level, a 30% linkage to climate in the MFF. With respect to agriculture policy, 40%. That's a great chance for all of us. But now we need a functioning and also efficient instrument in order to make clear that this is just more than a lip service. And that is one of the key elements in our negotiations with the European Parliament. But we have to send a clear message to the people in Europe who are afraid of losing their jobs in a very, very deep economic and social crisis, that the socio-ecological transformation of our economies is a huge chance for all of us to create new chance. And it's a unique chance for us to strengthen our competition in a globalized world. And that brings me to the second topic, multilateralism. I'm a bit disappointed that we don't discuss it in a more controversial and also inspiring way, because the EU is the biggest champion of multilateralism in the world. Multilateralism is in our DNA. In the Council conclusions of June 2019, we identified certain areas where we want to intensify our efforts to strengthen the multilateral system. Three of these areas strike me as particularly important. First, given that the EU is the most active advocate of multilateralism, we need a well-coordinated and strong EU presence in multilateral organizations. This also means we have to cooperate better when it comes to filling leadership positions and proposing EU candidates for them. Second, Europe now only represents a fraction of members of the United Nations. This means we need to build a network of partnerships across the globe to advance a positive international agenda. This is why we have initiated the Alliance for Multilateralism, which is a format that brings together foreign ministers from around the world who are committed to multilateralism. And third, we need to reform international organizations so that they are able to provide us with solutions for the challenges of today and tomorrow. This means that we as the EU must actively support the lessons learned process within the WHO, as well as the reform of WTO, the World Bank, and the United Nations system. So, maybe the pandemic can promote all these ideas, because nobody should stand alone and we have to learn our lessons. And my big thanks to Tytti. She is one of the most distinguished fighters for European Union, which stands for common values, for the rule of law. It's extremely important that we defend and protect the rule of law within the European Union to regain trust and confidence on the global stage. But it's extremely controversial. We have to invest a lot of time and energy to convince others that the European Union is not just an economic project. Again, we are a political project based on common values, and we have to defend them. And this is very, very, very challenging and demanding in these times, because we are very much focused in this crisis mode on economic issues, on social issues, on health issues. We coordinate the whole day. But at the end, we shouldn't forget that we are much more than an economic project or an institution which provides money for forward-looking projects.
Thank you very much for this very clear elaboration also on the issue of multilateralism and trying to give us some inspiration of what to deal with. And it seems to me you might have kind of had an eye on the chat, because I think that you already answered the question that Juha Jokela was questioning or putting into the chat, because he was exactly asking what would be your priority areas and institutions in defending rules-based order and multilateralism. So that was exactly your answer to that question. And he just confirms. We have one remaining question in the chat that is more, I mean, also in view of the economic recovery and the Green Deal, is more putting an eye on energy mixes and in how far Germany, giving the example of Germany, who is moving from nuclear power to Russian gas and Finnish-owned coal. Could Germany make a Green Deal and use recovery money to modernize the existing emission-free nuclear plants and show that the recovery money must be used to return giving green investments? So basically, it's more a question how far also energy mixes of a country could contribute to the Green Deal issue, and also that the recovery monies are invested correctly or with an eye to the future development. I don't see any further questions with regards from the broader audience. So I would simply like to give the ministers a final one sentence or two sentence opportunity for their final remarks. So again, Mrs. Tuppurainen, if you would want to give your concluding remarks for this discussion.
Thank you very much. Very shortly, if I may, I would just like to comment on what Piret said in her comment in the beginning, how to speak to the people, and there's one word, and it's just transition. And I'm very happy that we have a new fund, the Just Transition Fund, in the MFF and recovery package. That is the way to address the audience. We have to take into account that green transition, it's not just winning, there are sectors that are losing, and we have to make it socially sustainable, and that's where the Just Transition comes into the scene. But I would just like to conclude and once again invite us all to create a strategy which makes the EU world's most competitive, socially inclusive, carbon neutral economy in the world. Thank you so much for the opportunity to speak to you.
Thank you, Mrs. Tuppurainen. And now Michael Roth, one final concluding remark.
Thank you so much. The statement sounds a bit weird in my ears, because Germany is the only country worldwide who sent a very clear message. The age of coal and the age of nuclear energy will be over. And this is extremely challenging for our economy, that is extremely challenging for our societies. That's why we are very much in favor of renewable energy. And we build up new sources. We established a functioning and very, very successful legal system in order to make renewable energy as a success story, not just for the national stage, but also for Europe to encourage others on the global stage. But, and this is another dimension of this very important and crucial discussion, gas serves as a bridge builder between the existing energy mix and the Green Deal, a bright future without coal, a bright future without nuclear energy, but we need gas in the midterm, and that's why we very much interested in a more European energy strategy, energy supplies. This is not just a national challenge. It is much more an obligation for all of us in the European Union to establish a system and a strategy which bases on solidarity, but also efficiency and sustainability. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you very much for the two ministers who shared their time with us and their thoughts with us, which we are all going to take with us into our discussions tomorrow. I'm also want to thank our three commentators for their contributions, and we're mostly happily also taking these comments into our further discussions. And we're actually going to elaborate a discussion paper, which we're going to share with the broader public, so you can watch out for that. But for now, I would like to thank everybody and wish you all a nice evening. Thank you very much.